بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Inshallah, we have an hour to give a presentation, an introduction of the Akhlaq and Suluk. Al-Akhlaq and Suluk. SubhanAllah, the interdiction of the maqasid and the akhlaq is kind of close to each other. Al-akhlaq are the morals and the suluk are the behavior and the conduct. And al-akhlaq comes from al-khuluq, and he said في اللغة جمع خلق. And خلق comes from the root of خلق تدل على تقدير الشيء, the evaluation of a thing, the esteem of a thing. And when we apply it to the khuluq, to the moral, al-khuluq means as-sajiyyatu. As-sajiyyatu is a nature. It's the nature. It's something embedded into the nafs. It becomes like a character. The khuluq is a character. One of the early scholars who gave a definition of al-khuluq or akhlaq to understand it in its in action is al-Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala. In the kulla, he's saying in his book, in the kulla sifa tadhharu fil qalb yadhharu atharuha ala al-jawab. Every characteristic that is start in the heart, you will see it is effect into the body. More than that, the body only acts based on what is in the heart. Therefore, the action of the human being is really attached or governed by the action of the heart. This is give us an introduction to get to the book, because the book, mashallah, Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah is going to give us the category of people. But this is give a whole perspective of what we want to study and an introduction of that. Therefore, the khuluq, it becomes, like he said, is a sajiyya, is a characteristic, is a nature, is a character. That's why when you try to say who's leading in our system, who's the leader? Either brain, the intellect, or the heart. In reality, it's the heart. The brain executes, the heart leads. And the means how to do it in the body. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Qala fil jasad mudgha idha saruhat saruha al jasad." There's a piece of flesh in the body. If it goes sound, the whole body goes sound. "Qala ala yahi wa hiya al qalb." It is the heart. Therefore, the heart is the one who leads. And the belief is what is settled in the heart and doesn't come back to the brain, to the intellect to argue it. Because if you have the brain to argue what you believe, it becomes doubt. That's why they believe it bypass the brain, it bypass the fact to think about it. You think of the existence of Allah. When you come to believe that Allah exists, not every time you want to do the hukm, you said, first I need to check if do Allah exist or not. So the believing in Allah, that's why it's the foundation of everything. In the foundation of all the action. That's why La ilaha illallah is the statement to come to the deen of Allah, to submit to Allah. Then we say La ilaha illallah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, now that you accepted and you believed in me, then submit, this is my way to follow, that I guarantee to you with it to the achievement of the happiness that every human being is seeking in this life, in his journey of life. Then when we come to the purification, so the way to act in way of justice, in way of peace, in way of righteousness, require to have khuluq, that is hasan, moral that is good. Then when we define the moral is a character, is something, is natural, you do things spontaneous. You cannot love by force. The love is spontaneous. It comes from the heart. And if someone, for example, he's the love that is set in his heart is the love of money. Right. Is the characteristic or like the behavior that he has is spontaneous behavior. He loves money. He adores to look at the money. He reads about the money. He works more than a shift to gain money. He's happy when money increases. He's sad when he's losing money. Why? Because what governs the host action is the love that he has in his heart. That's why we call it the Aqidah. The Aqidah, it was settled the heart on, that will become the engine of your action. And when we come to say, so this khuluq, this suluk, if the heart comes, everything comes from this engine, from this mudha, which is the heart. Then the cure, the cleansing of the heart is a necessity for the action to be righteous. That's, you find in the Quran, always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قال إنها for example قال أولم يسير في الأرض فتكون لهم قلوب يعقلون بها أو آذان يسمعون بها. Do not they travel in the earth to contemplate and ponder? He said to have hearts with which they conceive. Subhanallah. He add التعقل للقلب قلوب يعقلون بها. He said قال أولم يسير في الأرض. Then he said, قال فإنها لا تعمل أبصار. It's not the vision that is the blind, but the blindness when it hurt get to the heart, then the true blindness. إنها لا تعمل أبصار ولكن تعمل قلوب التي في الصدور. So the guide of every one of us is insight, and insight is with which he views and sees the truth and the force, the good and the bad. Therefore, the more the heart is clean and cleansed, when you say cleansed, it means like, you know, he has the belief in Allah, he has the submission to the way of Allah, the more he's gonna be provided by the best of the gift that Allah called Furqan criteria. Therefore, when someone wants to cleanse his heart as being the engine of the action, as being the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that's the source of the guidance, that's the source of the of life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talked about the disbeliever, قَالَ طَبَعَ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ, he put seal on their heart. He talked about the munafiqeen, قَالَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٍ, in their heart is disease. أولئك الذين ارتابت قلوبهم. They have doubt in their hearts. It's all about the hearts. Look at the Quran, how many ayah talks about the hearts. Therefore, what defines the being is the soundness or the corruption of his heart. That's why there's some of the hearts, subhanAllah, they go, come totally dead. And those who have their heart dead, they are already people of hellfire. Therefore, when someone wants to get into this path of correction, of cleansing, of purification, the path is the taqwa, piety. Just this is few terms that you get to put them together so we can start our book, inshallah. But those are very important, you know, terms and important introduction. When someone, for example, he wants to have taqwa, he wants to be purified, you ask the question, is my objective to become taqi, my objective to become pure, have a heart, pure heart, or the objective is something else? And this is the deviation, subhanAllah, that many of the sects, they fell into it. The taqwa is a way to take you to the real objective and the purification. The real objective is mardatullah, the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how can you get to the mardatullah, the vessel to take you to the mardatullah, to the pleasure of Allah, is the taqwa of Allah. So we don't become muttaqeen just for the sake to be muttaqeen. We want to be muttaqeen to reach the pleasure of Allah. We want to cleanse our heart, not for our greatness, to be someone who's like very pure and very noble and saint. No, we do that to reach the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, what is the sign of the purification? It's salamatu sadri, like someone's his breast, his chest is full in peace to fulfill the oath with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the oath with Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the ahd, the oath. Inna Allah ishtara min al-mu'minina anfusahum wa amwalahum bi anna lahum jannah. That's the oath. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bought from the believer their life and their wealth. In exchange, He will grant them the favor of the Jannah. Because in some other sects, we will come to talk to them with the book, inshallah ta'ala, and some of the fatwa that we're going to have from the book of Ilm al-Suluk of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. That sometimes a very subtle difference will make lead someone to corruption. Like some of the Sufi extreme, you know, the way they behave is like they forget the objective why they are, you know, into the path of the purification. Instead, the objective is Allah, it becomes the objective themselves. That's why it becomes, you know, praising the self greater than getting to the objective of submitting the self to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why if you go do some search, you find many people who are not even Muslim, they follow the Sufi sect. Why? Because some of them it becomes like it is about individuals, about the self, not about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Few concepts, inshallah, we share them together. in brief. When we're talking about akhlaq and suluk, moral, suluk, purification, we need to talk about, you know, the nafs, which is the self. So, we have kind of, every being, you know, is confronted to set of, in this life, you know, he has his own self. He has, in one side is the dunya, and in the dunya, what he has is confronting is al-bala, test, trials, tribulation, which is the nature of this life. So we have hayat, life, nafs, self, ibtila, trial and tribulation. Al-hayat al-dunya, we have this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala call it mata'ul ghubur. That's the true definition of life. Is a commodity leading to delusion, leading to deviation. Anyone who holds on this life is going to perish, and then he's holding on an illusion. The people who all their concern in this life, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they're running behind a mirage. So this is the life. So the life, if we don't conceive it as a place of investment, of sowing, of helping or building for the true life, is someone who's already missing the point and deviating from his purpose of life. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى ويوم تقوم الساعة يقسم المجرمون ما لبثوا غير ساعة كذلك كانوا يؤفكون. Those deviated, when the hours will come in the day of judgment, they will be swearing by Allah, Ya Allah, wallahi, you only spend only an hour in the dunya. That's the true meaning of life. قل متاع الدنيا قليل. The commodity of this dunya is very little. وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ. The hereafter is better for those who fear Allah. Allah called this قَالَ دَارُ لَهْوٍ وَلَعَبْ وَزِينَةٌ وَتَفَاخُرٍ. Play, joke, adornment, and boasting, and showing off. That's what how Allah defined this life. As mentioned in Surah Al-Hadid. Allah called this life Darul Ghurur, as we said, home of illusions, home of misleading. Darul Ighwa, you know, the same thing almost. Darul Dhalal wa Tughyan, misleading, corruption. Darul La'na lil Mu'anideen. Darul Tila is the home or the of trials. This is the meaning of life. So anyone, when he comes to study this, and as someone who seeking the purification of his soul, he needs first to set himself on defining this life from how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defined it for us. But if someone sees success in this life, that he's already of the understanding of the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, you should not confuse that it doesn't mean that we should not make success in this life. No. The success is actually required from the believer. Success in his business, success in his studies. But the success that he's going to do here is part of his worship. Allah asking you to be successful. Ask you to build. Ask you to make high building, ask you to be the best of the doctor, ask you to be the best of the engineer, because part of the biogenesis on earth. But you do all this to make money, to fulfill your desire, that is the wrong way, because he made the success is the fulfillment of the desire with whatever he can accumulate in this life. This is the deviation. Comes to an-nafs, the self. The self or the soul depends on the way how we define. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, three types of nafs. Three types. Every one of us has three types. There's al-nafsu al-ammara. Al-nafsu al-ammara. A type of ourself who's ammara. Ammara, it means, inciting someone to do evil. As the human being is composed of two substances, the body and the soul. The body is always inclined to the loneliness, desire. This part of our nafs is always inciting someone to do that. It's fine to do your desire. Do this, do this. It's all about, accumulating. It's about fulfilling, whatever someone he feels. That's the nafs al-ammar. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the nafs al-ammara in Surati Yusuf. As she said, Imra'atul Aziz, وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ. I should not, make myself innocent. Indeed, I did the same. And the nafs is indeed أَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ. أَمَّارَة, order, ordained to do bad. And as Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, that we want to study, he mentioned the thing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he taught us to seek refuge from this type of nafs. In the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, قال وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ أَنفُسِنَا. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil part of ourselves. The second nafs is an-nafs al-lawwama. An-nafs al-lawwama, the one who has that remorse, that reproach. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Qiyam. An-nafs al-lawwama, that part of you say you should not do that. This is wrong. That's the nafs al-lawwama. That nafs al-lawwama, as soon as you do something bad, comes to you to regret. Why did you do this? You should not have done it. So that's النفس اللوام. And Allah mentioned in Surah Al-Qiyam. Then there's النفس المطمئنة, the peaceful nafs. The peaceful nafs. The peaceful nafs is that part of us who's peaceful, who with the taqwa, with the cleansing, with the purification, reach this level of peace. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Fajr, when he said, O peaceful soul, come back to Allah. Ya ayyatuha an-nafs al-mutma'inna, irji'i ila rabbiki radiyatan mardiyah. These are the types of nafs. There's other characteristic of the nafs, also three. Let's say, instead of calling this, this kind of power, if you can say power, something that drive the person from his own nafs, let's say they call them the drive. Three types of drives. They have the intellectual drive. The intellectual drive will lead to the wisdom. like a power, or like strength that someone's skills part. There's a drive, we call it, you know, al-bihimiyya. Bihimiyya is like kind of a cattle, kind of animal, you know, let's say, something that is from desire, a drive of desire. Which is the desire here, the scholar, that, you know, they assimilate it to the kind of the cattle, you know, eat, and they do the thing that they just to say, satisfy their desires, eat and reproduce. There's another drive, which is the anger drive, which is more the scholar that assimilated to as-sab'iyya, to the beast, you know, anger, fight, conflict, you know, dispute. He, subhanAllah, comes from this part of our nafs. Desire, eating, doing all those things, accumulating, this comes from the ash-shahwa. And there's thinking, writing, wisdom that comes from this, the drive, which is the intellect part. And everyone has this drive. How to cleanse it, to put it in the middle way to help you in your life? The intellect, the balanced one, when you have a balance of this intellect, you reach wisdom. When you use it too much, it becomes someone he believes that he is God. Like some people, they think that they are so smart, they believe they are gods. If someone, you know, will not even take care of it, keep himself or herself ignorant, it leads to idiocy. This drive of desire, if someone make it in the middle, cleanse it in the way of Allah, needs to chastity. To go overboard needs to the fujur, evilness. To not do it again, you know, to not satisfy, needs to like denial. When it comes to the anger, the balance of the anger leads to bravery and courage. Excessiveness leads to tahawwa, you know, chaos, you know, it's like, you know, dhulm. And not taking care of it or neglected leads to cowardice. Therefore, if you see, the first time the Sharia comes to balance it in a way to extract that peaceful soul, and this drive to cleanse them, to be a drive for goodness, no drive for evil. The last point is the ibtila, tribulation, trials. The ibtila is a fact of life, is a reality that all of us will live. So the ibtila is an element embedded in the journey of our life. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنَ عَمَلًا, to test you who among you is the best indeed. And for the believer, they have a special ibtila. When you say, I believe, Allah is going to test you for that, to show how truthful you are. أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ. Do people think that they're going to be left alone without being tested when they say, we believe? This is an introduction of the concept to lead us, insha'Allah ta'ala, to study the element of the tazkiyah, of the akhlaq, and following, insha'Allah, the book of التحفه العراقيه and also some of the fatawa باذن الله تعالى concerning the اخلاق and the تزكيه. Any question? Allah said, قال ولقد ذرأنا لجهنم. So we created for hellfire. Huh? من الجن والإنس. كثيرة من الجن والإنس. نحن ذرأنا, if you remember, when we study the القضاء والقدر, the divine will and predestination, الذرء والخلق. And الخلق only comes to existence when it happens. So this dara is in the knowledge of Allah that this type of creation or this group of creation, they come to act with the action of people of heaven. So dara, it comes as entering into existence, effective. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that كثير من الجن والإنس قلوب لا يعقلون. وأبصار وأعين لا يبصرون بها وآذان لا يسمعون بها. Why Allah mentioned hearts, eyes, and ears? The eyes and the ears are the channel of the knowledge. You contemplate, you see, you hear the revelation, you see the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم how he's doing, you see, you know, so those are the channel of knowledge. If the channel of knowledge are sound, but the heart is dead, then whatever is got there cannot enter. It bows and he gets rejected. Because that heart dead, as he cannot get the light of the guidance, is acting upon his own self, upon the whims. And the whims was fed by the shahawat, that nafs who had that, you know, the desire, and this desire are, you know, whose becomes, you know, the what feeding the heart, and the heart is driving the whole body to do everything wrong. Well,
just a moment.
Huh?
Bypass.
إلا أن تقطع قلوبه. May Allah, the bypass is the tawbah. جزاكم الله خير وبارك الله فيكم. See you next time إن شاء الله تعالى.